I can get by all right.
So I'm not sure, are we going to sing Love Divine first? Okay, third verse of Love Divine. Unbounded God, we thank you for this wonderful world and breathtaking universe that is our home.
Lord Jesus, we place this globe at the cross to remind us that you love the world and will save the world.
Holy God,
finish then thy new creation.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome. As most of you know, there was a party yesterday here for Tony Ashwell and John Simpkins, and they did This Is Your Life for both of them. There is also, I don't know if anybody got one, a brochure with on John Simpkins' This Is Your Life. And there's some left over, and they're out in the Oasis Lounge if anybody wants one. Okay, thank you. Now pass you over to Stuart.
Morning, everyone. Am I on? Yes. It's great to see you on not such a nice day. We seem to get fine weather on one day and then several days of not such good weather and then maybe another fine one. So we're looking forward to when the spring really springs, aren't we not? Today is Mothering Sunday, of course, Lent 4. So we're halfway through to Easter. And the theme of my service today will be thinking further about the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is like all sorts of different things that Jesus used as examples. We'll come to that later. Let's just have a very short prayer. In the praise of the Creator, in the presence of the Saviour, in the power of the Spirit, we come. Amen. So we sing together, a hymn is number 39, a hymn which involves angels quite a bit. I hope you're okay with angels. It's angel voices ever singing round thy throne of lights.
Thank you.
So let's join together in prayer. Eternal God, we praise you, for you are the source of light and life. Your word made the whole creation in all its beauty and splendor, bringing order out of chaos, light out of darkness. So we praise you that the evidence of your creative activity is all around us still. We praise you, Father, for your supreme revelation of yourself in our Lord Jesus Christ, and for the clear vision of your love that we see in him. Inspire us now with the life and light he came to bring, that our praises may be worthy of him and resound to his honor and glory. For his sake we pray this. Amen. Then a prayer of confession. Father, you know us better than we know ourselves. And in the light of your glory, all the darkness of our sin is revealed. In your presence, we confess our failure to respond fully to your commandment to love, our reluctance to follow you, our desire to please ourselves rather than to serve you. We confess that we have only feebly responded to that clear revelation given to us in Jesus, and that we have allowed the light of his glory to be obscured by our own apathy and indifference. Father, you know us better than we know ourselves, but we know that we are sinners. Grant us an awareness of sins forgiven and of your abundant grace. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And together we say the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. On a visit to the United States, we went in May, and we were rather surprised to find that they have in May their Mother's Sunday, Mothering Sunday. Why do we hold it on different dates? Well, of course, I had to go to the authority on all matters such as this, to Google, and this is what they told me. In the UK, Mother's Day is always held on the fourth Sunday of the Christian festival of Lent. The custom came about because this was the traditional, this was traditionally when those who had moved away for work came back and visited their mother church and their own mothers, which is also why we often refer to it as Mothering Sunday. So it was created to provide opportunities for people who had gone away to work to come back to their church and to their homes. And I was a bit surprised that, traditionally anybody was further than the gates of their town. We thought everybody lived in one place for the rest of their lives, didn't they? But it seems they didn't even do that then. They went off to work, and so they came back on Mothering Sunday. Lovely idea. I wonder how many people here aren't supposed to be here today. You're supposed to be at your mother church, and I bet that's not next door. How many people here, for instance, were born in Bishop Stortford or nearby? Put your hands up if you were. There's one or two, three or four or five. So the rest of you weren't. Now that's going to be interesting. How many have been here for something like 50 years? Oh, that's a few more. What about 25 years? Yes. I'm 24, so can I put a half hand up for that? And what about those who've moved here in the last 5 years? Anybody? Yes? One, two, three, four? Yes? Well, welcome, by the way. But you see what I mean? We are very much a gathered community, all the time gathering and then disappearing again. So it seems that the original intention applies to us now. It would be good to go to your mother church if you aren't living your whole lives here. But the thing has changed. It's no longer about churches so much as about mothers. It's about families. And of course, most people will be having time with their families this weekend. And it can be a joyful occasion, but one has to remember that for many people, Mothering Sunday can be quite painful. To acknowledge the festival of Mothering Sunday, therefore, we're now going to give out some floral gifts. In my previous churches, these were done to the ladies. I hear that here the men get it too. Isn't that generous? So off you go. Let's see the poses coming round. And I think we have several people to help with this. Is that right? Yes. Thank you. Thank you, ladies. And six people actually put them together, and they're lovely, aren't they? So thank you, all of you who are involved. We turn now to a hymn which is a Mothering Sunday hymn, number 120. 120, we gladly celebrate and praise the gift so great and good. Number 120. To recap, because we're doing a series on the Kingdom of God, I had already one service on that subject, which was last January. This year, not last year, of course. And I talked about 3,000 years of the Kingdom of God. It was a bit of a history lesson. And if you remember, the Old Testament never uses the term the Kingdom of God because it can't use the word God. But it was all about the Kingdom of God throughout its pages. The New Testament, Jesus taught a lot about the Kingdom of God. It was the focus point of his preaching and teaching. And then after, when we have the new church, they were all expecting the Kingdom of God to come any day. Waking up in the morning wondering, is this the day? Looking round the corner and seeing if Jesus was on his way, but they learnt that it wasn't so fast as that. It was not coming for quite a while. So today, we're going to look at three Bible readings about the kingdom of God, which refer to one reading which we won't read, but you know so well. I will speak about that as well. The parable of the prodigal son. And then I'm going to share a little of my own beliefs in the kingdom of God, and we will look at six contemporary examples of it. But starting with those Bible readings. Jesus said a lot about the kingdom of God, and the kingdom of heaven in Matthew's case, which is the same as the kingdom of God, just Matthew didn't want to use the word God either. He spoke in parables, not straight talk. He introduced the kingdom of God often with the phrase, the kingdom of God is like, and then he went on to tell his parable. So we look at our first example, which is from Matthew 13, 31 to 32. It's about the kingdom of God growing slowly, silently, from a tiny piece of dust to a huge shrubby tree. Ruth will now read it for us.
The mustard seed and the leaven. He put another parable before them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed that a man took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it's grown, it is larger than all the garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches.
Thank you, Ruth. I'm not going to talk about mustard seed, but I'm going to talk about petunias. There is some similarity, I can assure you, but not exactly the same. And I'm going to talk about them because petunia seed is tiny. Has anybody tried to sow petunia seed? Yes, one or two. It's so tiny that you pour it out into your hand and it looks like dust. If you cough or sneeze, you lose the lot, which is a bit of a shame because it's actually more expensive than its equivalent in equivalent rate of gold per ounce. So it's a pricey thing to mess about. And we used to grow a lot of petunias in my father's nursery. And so I used to go down on Friday nights to do the sowing when nobody was around to cough or splutter or open a door and blow all my seed away. It creates a beautiful bush, doesn't it? Lovely plants, petunias. And it's a lovely example of the tiniest thing producing something very beautiful. It gives us faith that God is working his purpose out when we see the miracle of life coming like that. Now, I don't believe in a perfect plan for each one of us, all predetermined. His purposes weave themselves around our free will decisions somehow. How they do that, I haven't got a clue. But that's what God does. Gives us free will and then weaves his story around that. Let's move now to another example. This one is from Matthew chapter 13. And again, Ruth will read it for us.
Not quite as nice as petunias. The parable of the weeds. He put another parable before them, saying, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master's house came to him and said, Master, did you not sow good seed in your fields? How is it then that weeds are there? He said to them, an enemy has done this. So the servant said to him, then do you want us to go and gather them? But he said, no, lest in gathering the weeds, you root up the wheat along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.
Thank you, Ruth. So this kingdom, this story is about the judgment of God. The kingdom of God is a place for judgment, and judgment comes in God's good time, not when we actually want it, because we always want it straight away, don't we? We always want God's kingdom straight away. My brother split on me when I pinched an extra sweet out of the sweet tray. He went and told my parents. I wanted instantaneous bolts from heaven to come down and crash on him, despite the fact that I, of course, was guilty of thieving. But, you know, telling my parents was much worse. And I didn't speak to him for 5 minutes afterwards. The kingdom of God is not like that. God, in his perfection, knows the right time for things to happen. Another example is Matthew 25. The kingdom of God comes as a surprise, and that too we'll hear read for us by Ruth.
The parable of the 10 virgins. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish, and five of them were wise. For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. Then the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, there was a cry, "Here is the bridegroom, come out and meet him." Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish ones said to the wise, "Give me some of your oil for my lamp. Our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, "Since there will not be enough for us and for you, go to the dealers and buy some yourselves." And while they were going to buy the oil, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterwards, the other virgins came, also saying, "Lord, Lord, open the door for us." But he answered, "Truly, I say to you, I do not know you. Watch, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Ruth. Thank you. So that one's talking about being alert. It's here, it's there, it's popping up all over the place. There may be periods when not a great deal is happening in the kingdom of God, perhaps. But then we just have to wait, like the women in that last story had to wait, like Simeon in the temple had to wait. And then things begin to happen. Be alert, have your lamps ready. Be ready. We used to have trouble with our children when we were going anywhere, that they weren't ready when we needed to leave. Did anybody have that problem as well, or were we on our own? Yeah. I'm relieved to hear that we were. So we used to sort of get to the front door, yell, shout, "Come on, you're supposed to be going." And, you know, they were saying, "Well, I just need to, just got to, just, yeah," and it takes time. So one day we got to the front door expecting to do the usual thing, and they were all there. They were all ready. We were so surprised. What on earth's going on here? We're so used to this business of pulling them together again. But they surprised us. I can't remember where we were going. Clearly it was somewhere they really wanted to go, and that must be the reason why. But you can be surprised by what your kids do, can't you? The kingdom of God comes with many surprises. Be alert. Be ready. And now to the last example, which we're not reading today because it's long. It's the parable of the prodigal son. We always call it the prodigal son, but it's really focusing on the wrong person. The real interesting part is the father. And that's who we concentrate on now. It's the father who is demonstrating his amazing love for his son, despite whatever the son is getting up to. He's waiting and waiting for him and clearly looking on the horizon to see if he is coming home. God is waiting for us all the time. He gives us the gift of free will. But he must be on the edge of his seat wondering how we will use it when every situation that we face, he's waiting there in love for us to show our decision. He invites us all to his great home at the end of our lives, and there'll be an amazing party for us when we get there. The prodigal son was very fortunate to have such a loving father. We too are fortunate to have a loving God. Jesus was very fond of saying the kingdom of God is like this or like that. And he used parables because the subject is so deep that the best way of conveying it was in metaphors and stories. Picture language, and it required reflection and interpretation. But when you get a picture, you can go on thinking about it later. It's something you can focus on, and his stories were something that the people who heard them could focus on. Remember, they couldn't see them written down. That was their one chance of getting that story into their minds. But a story can be remembered, can be shared. And so Jesus used stories to describe the kingdom of God with all its topsy-turvy nature and its twists and turns and its upside-down thinking, a reflection of the divine in all its majesty, in communion with us, earth-based human beings. Are we not fortunate that we have a God who cares so much that he sent his son? It's not surprising that the whole business of the kingdom of God leaves us panting a bit. It's, of course, not a place, but a context. Wherever God's will is being done, there is the kingdom of God. And in a moment, I will share with you some modern metaphors. But first, we're going to sing another hymn. It's number 255, a hymn about the kingdom. The kingdom of God is justice and joy, for Jesus restores what sin would destroy. 255.
Thank you.
So I'm going to share with you a few things that struck me about the kingdom of God. I'm going to use metaphors, which is what Jesus was doing all the time, and what's good enough for him is certainly good enough for me. I'm going to do it by showing you a series of pictures of objects that we can reflect about, because Jesus was often using little bits of things that were happening, things that were events or items that helped him to describe the kingdom of God, and we'll do that. So I'll show you a picture, ask the question, what can it say to you about the kingdom? And we will then have a pause, half a minute, something like that, time for you to reflect on what does that picture mean to you in terms of the kingdom of God? What might Jesus say about it in his teaching? And the first one is going to be a candle. What can it say to you about the kingdom? Reflect on that quietly for a few minutes. To me, it says something about vulnerability. It's so easy that it could get blown out. Of course, when you're trying to blow out the candles on your cakes, then it takes more puff than you expect, but it is so easy to lose the light. If you walk around with a candle, you have to shield it. The kingdom of God is very vulnerable. The kingdom of God is not masterful at all. It doesn't force itself on anyone. But a tiny light in a dark place can be very illuminating. And we live in a world that's getting darker. And the lights that we can share about the love of God can become even brighter in a dark place. Jesus says, "Don't put your light under a bushel. Let it shine. Risk it. It's worth it. For the kingdom of God is like a candle, a context where risks are taken, but the real truth can be revealed." So to our next example, the kingdom of God is like a mirror. What can it say to us about the kingdom today? It has no value, of course, unless it reflects. You can't see through it if it's doing its job properly. It reflects you, which might not always be good news, of course, I admit. But it can also reflect other things, like in the mirror, the face of a loved one standing close by. I remember Brenda and I going to Ely Cathedral some fairly considerable number of years ago. And we'd been looking around the cathedral until we came to a mirror. and it enabled you to look at the ceiling. And we had not looked up at the ceiling, having been there for 20 minutes or so. And suddenly we saw in the mirror this gorgeous ceiling. They were cleaning it. And you could see where they'd been and where they hadn't. And the part they'd been was absolutely astonishing. The mirror shared the beauty with us. So kingdom-wise, a mirror can reflect God's truth in the experiences of our lives. It can reflect God's sadness in the horrors of our world. It can reflect God's love and commitment in the sacrifice and the sacrificial love of people who are carers. The kingdom of God is like a mirror, and in its context, the context of the mirror is that it is about reflecting God. So to the third example, the kingdom of God is like a book. What can it say to us about the kingdom? Well, of course, it depends what sort of book it is. I've got one here entitled The Constitution, Practice and Discipleship of the Methodist Church, Volume 2. These are the rules by which the church will be run. And I'm supposed to know the lot, aren't I? Well, perhaps not, but anyway. And it's interesting, we've developed all these rules, presumably because things have gone wrong and we put a new rule in the book and added yet another and then yet another. And in Galatians, you can read this, God sent his son, he came to redeem those who were under the law so that they might become sons of God. We are always in danger of letting the book of rules run our lives. But I have another book here. It's poems by Hafiz, a great Sufi master. Muslim poet of the 14th century. Unexpected truths from unexpected sources. A wonderful revelation of the God we adore from a completely different direction. Just listen to this. Slipping on my shoes. Boiling water, toasting bread, buttering the sky. That should be enough contact with God in one day to make everyone crazy. Isn't that powerful? It's another source. And amazing that that source loves God at least as much as we do. On to our next example. The kingdom of God is like a wedding ring. What does that say to us about the kingdom? Well, for me, it says something about accepting me as I am, accepting her as she is. One day we were chatting to our children about things generally, and we were talking about our getting together, and they said to us, didn't you live together before you got married? And we felt very pious, of course, and said, no, of course we didn't. We didn't do that sort of thing in those days. Goodness me. And they turned around and said, what a risk you took. And suddenly we found we were actually being accused of taking unnecessary risks and should have actually, you know, lived together before we tied the knot. Strange how things do circles, isn't it? It really is. A wedding ring, does that not show God accepting us as we are? Come unto me, all with heavy burdens. Gracious acceptance of us as we are. A love that seems to know no bounds. Forgive them, Father. They don't know what they're doing. A love that is full of the commitment of the prodigal father in that story of Jesus. The kingdom of God is like a perfect wedding ring, a joyous place of acceptance. Our penultimate example is the kingdom of God is like a cross. What does that say to us? This is a broken cross. One side of it's okay, the other side is shattered. And the shattered side represents what the devil would do and how have us to do, and sometimes we do it. Twisted and contorted. Human nature at its worst. But then there's another cross which is perfect. That's a cross that's been restored and redeemed. Love shining out even when bleeding with self-sacrifice. It says the kingdom of God is on the side of the broken, and that includes us. The cross is a scene of utter contradiction, where God reminds us that he can make everything that happens still a part of his kingdom somehow. The kingdom of God is like a cross, an extraordinary place to find any good news. And so finally to the last, and that's the kingdom of God is like bread and wine. What does that say to us about the kingdom? To me, it says the glory of God is present with us now. Bread represents the ordinary physical things of life and the extraordinary physical things of life. The Celts were good at it, weren't they? God of the wind and weather, God of tide and moon, God in the tasks of the home and the tasks of the farm. All our physical lives. Thomas wanted physical proof of the resurrection. Unless I see his hands and touch his fingers, the marks of his nails. Proof for Thomas was created by touching. For us, tasting the bread represents the victory of the physical part of the kingdom, whilst the wine represents the victory of the spirit. What we can't see or touch, what causes tears to flow, what makes one leap with joy? I leap with joy when I hear that Fort William Football Club have scored a goal. It's so rare, apparently. It's good to hear they've had something to cheer. Bread and wine together represent the glory of the kingdom of God here with us all now, every minute of every day. These are just a few metaphors that I'm sharing with you. But you could find all sorts of other metaphors that are true in your life too. Items, places, people that remind you of the wonder of the kingdom of God. Next time we'll look at the kingdom of God. And what about the future? That's for another day. Now we will sing. The hymn is number 416, then 416. There's a wideness in God's mercy like the wideness of the sea. Please be seated. So to our prayers of intercession, let us pray. Lord, we pray for the Israel and Gaza peoples. For the fear of the people of Israel who live shoulder to shoulder with people they sadly hate. For the desperate state of the people of Gaza in the hands of Hamas, who want to eliminate Israel from their land and who therefore perpetuate this war. We are deeply aware of the terrible state of food and water reserves for the Palestinians in Gaza. Be with all who can have a beneficial effect on this ghastly situation and bring relief of food and water, medical supplies and fuel. Give wisdom and a sense of mercy to their leaders and to world leaders in dealing with the various crises that are facing these people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for His Majesty the King and for Kate, Princess of Wales. Remember those we know who are facing health issues. We ask your blessing on Janice and Barbara. We thank you for the good news about Jack and Tom. We pray too for Joanna and ask that you will encourage girls to join our Girls Brigade, that it will be a place of community, love, and fun. Bless too Tony Ashwell and John and Kathleen as they have all celebrated birthdays recently. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. To this prayer we bring in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll take up the collection as we sing the next hymn. The hymn is, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky, I have heard my people cry. Number 663. The collection will be taken up as we sing.
Thank you.
thank you, Lord, for the gifts you give us continuously. Help us to see the giver in them and share our knowledge of him with all we meet day by day. We close by saying together the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, reign with us all evermore.